Hello. Welcome to today's program of the Sousa Mendes Foundation. My name is Olivia Mattis, and on behalf of the foundation, I would like to welcome you today. So, behind me are a couple of props that you haven't seen in previous programs. We have George himself sitting there watching the program, and we have the first edition from 1941. Of the first book published by the Reys in the United States. This is the book that Hans and Margret Rey carried with them during the Exodus in manuscript. And they published the book when they finally arrived in New York. So there would be no Curious George without our hero, Aristides de Sousa Mendes. And that's pretty incredible. So, we here at the Sousa Mendes Foundation are helping to create a museum in Portugal in the house of Sousa Mendes, the house that had fallen into a state of ruin following his death in 1954 in poverty and disgrace. But now it's rising like a phoenix from the ashes, and it's going to be a glorious museum. So these two items behind me and many more are being donated to the museum and will be on display forever. So before we get going with today's program and my introduction of today's illustrious speakers, we're going to have a little clip of this wonderful film that you have seen.
Everybody thinks Curious George is such an American icon, and of course he is. But he was created by German Jews who lived in Paris, took him through Brazil, and then brought him to the United States. So he's as much of an immigrant as anyone. There are George's adventures, but then there are the Reys' adventures.
Great. So today we are very privileged to have two fantastic speakers. We have the Holocaust historian, Dr. Susan Zuccotti, and she is really the authority on the Holocaust in both France and in Italy. And we're going to put links to some of her books or to her Amazon page into the chat box so that you can explore more of her books and you can order them and learn from her. Our second speaker will be the filmmaker. And she's coming to us from Japan. And that's why we're having our program at an unusual time for us, 5 p.m. East Coast time. It's 7 a.m. right now in Japan. And I'm so grateful to Ema Ryan Yamazaki for getting up early to participate in today's program. So, Ema has just returned from the Sundance Film Festival, where she presented her newest film called The Black Box Diaries, that apparently is going to win a lot of prizes, we hope. And I was also very pleased to see a big article by Emma in a recent edition of the New York Times about what it's like to grow up as a multi-ethnic, multiracial person in Japan. Emma has Japanese roots and British roots, and she interviewed a lot of people for that article that I really encourage you to check out. So, first, we're going to hear from Susan, Dr. Zuccotti, then, we're going to hear from our filmmaker, Ema Ryan Yamazaki. In the meantime, audience members, I encourage you to be putting your questions into the chat box. We do not recognize raised hands. You have to literally write your question into the chat box. And I hope you have a lot of questions for our speakers today. So, Dr. Zuccotti, Susan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Olivia. Thank you, audience, all of you for coming today, attending today. And I'm very pleased to be part of this presentation. We all tend to remember the Dreyfus Affair and other ugly anti-Semitic incidents in the late 19th century in France. But we should also remember that before World War II, France was in many ways one of the European nations most sympathetic to Jews. And during the same period, anti-Semitism was probably less prevalent in France than in the United States. In the late 19th and early 20th century, a large proportion of Jews in France had been French for generations, and most of them were highly assimilated, very active in French life, and very happy to be there. Thousands of Jews, French and foreign immigrants alike, volunteered for military service in the French army during the First World War and fought and died for that country. After World War I, in the 1920s, immigrants in general, Jewish and non-Jewish alike, were welcome in France. Workers were desperately needed to rebuild after the devastation of World War I, and tens of thousands of impoverished Jews came to France in search of jobs and an escape from post-World War I persecution in Eastern Europe. Things changed in the 1930s during the period when Hans and Margret Rey came to France, 1935. Worldwide depression and mass unemployment meant that immigrants in general were no longer quite so welcome in France. Indeed, they were now often seen as a drain on the economy and the takers of jobs that should go to the French. Anti-Semitism grew along with fanatic right-wing groups. In 1933, Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany, and pressure on the Jews throughout most of Europe intensified greatly. Many anti-Nazi and left-wing refugees from the Third Reich fled to France in the post-Hitler period, but hostility was growing. Still, we must remember that tens of thousands of French Jews continued to thrive during the 1930s. One of them, Léon Blum, even became Prime Minister of France in 1936. No Jewish American has ever reached such a prominent position in the United States. You know much about the Reys from the film that you've seen, but I would like to stress a few points. Hans Reiersbach, Rey was his pen name, born in 1898, had served in a medical unit in France and Russia during the First World War. So he had already seen a lifetime of unspeakable horrors when he was barely 20 years old. He left Germany for Brazil in 1923 or 1924. As for Margaret, she was from a very prominent German Jewish family. Her father, David Felix Wallstein, had been a member of the German Reichstag for a short time in the 1920s, and he was a leader of the extremely important Central Association of German Citizens of Jewish Faith until it was abolished by Hitler in 1938. Margaret arrived in Brazil in 1935, in part probably in an effort to leave the Nazis behind. Hans and Margaret married on August 16, 1935, went to Paris on their honeymoon, and decided to stay. On September 1st, 1939, the Germans invaded Poland and France and Britain declared war. But then the phony war ensued. France and Britain mobilized, but their armies did not engage the Germans on the Western Front or do anything to help the Poles. Hans and Margret Rey remained quite safely and comfortably in France during this phony war period. In the early months of the phony war, the French government arrested and interned about 15,000 male immigrants from the Third Reich under the age of 50, both Jews and non-Jews, who were defined by the French government as, quote, dangerous enemy aliens. Most of them were refugees from Hitler, but Hans Rey would have been eligible for arrest and internment as a German or stateless immigrant, except for the fact that he was a Brazilian citizen.
We were living in the Normandy in a little town called Avranches. We lived there for months and had a lovely time. Then Hitler's invasion to Holland, Belgium, and France.
The invasion of May 10th changed the scene in France greatly. Parisians are no fools. They're not blind to the enemy within their gates. Police check up for suspected persons.
They were German Jews holding Brazilian passports. So everywhere they went, they were suspect.
Somehow they had found out that we were born in Germany. From that moment on, we were spies. The chief of police, who was our friend, said, look, it's difficult to protect you here. You better go back to Paris. When we came to the station, two big fat men were standing there, put their hands on my husband's shoulder and said, you do not leave. They started looking through our luggage. They took hours and hours. I asked, what do you want from us? What are you doing here? They said, shut up. It was a very bad situation. The last suitcase he opened at the bottom, there were books we had done. At that moment, the whole atmosphere changed, you know, the heat was off. They let us go. I'm pretty damn sure it was George who saved us there.
I would like to show you this chronology because I want to make you understand how tremendously rapid the German advance through France was after the initial German invasion of France on May 15, 1940. This is, of course, important for many reasons, but for our purposes, it makes us understand the nature of the enormous chaotic refugee exodus from Paris to the south of France, in which the Reys participated. You can also see from this chronology that on May 28th, less than 2 weeks after the German army invaded France, the Belgians surrendered, totally unexpected. More than 2 million terrified refugees from Belgium and northern France were suddenly fleeing south through France, filling the trains, driving vehicles that quickly broke down or ran out of gas, bicycling, walking, interfering with military maneuvers, and spreading tales of German atrocities, some remembered from the First World War, some actually seen in 1940, some exaggerated, some not. But the mention of the atrocities in particular caused mass panic. Just a few days later, on June 3rd, Parisians experienced the first bombardment of their city. Also unexpected, French propaganda had been telling the French people all along not to worry. The Germans would surely be stopped on the Marne, just as they had been in 1914. In theaters, men and women had been seeing films of what the German army had been doing in Poland since September 1939, destroying cities, massacring civilians. Panic grew and grew and grew. 6 days later, on June 9th, Parisians saw their government begin to abandon Paris to resettle in Tours. 3 days after that, on June 12th, Parisians could hear distant cannon fire for the first time. The panic was complete and terrifying. Hans and Margret Rey left Paris on that day, June 12th. They joined the massive, desperate exodus, a mere two days later, on June 14th, the German army entered Paris. I don't think I have much to, I have to tell you much about the exodus itself, because you have seen the very fine films of it on the general film that you have seen before this presentation, except that the film does not really show the full horror of the exodus. German planes were shooting and bombing the refugees to increase the chaos and the panic. Trains obliged by the bombing to move only at night. Cars stalled, barely moving, clogging the roads. No food, no shelter. Women and children, babies and old people. And the film you saw does not provide quite the full picture of the responses of French villagers who now saw millions, literally millions of desperate strangers, including Parisians, straggling through their towns. Some local people were kind, as Margaret tells us. Others were merciless, charging a fortune for a glass of water, denying shelter, anxious to get the strangers out of town. From the map, I would like just to repeat what you have already understood. On the first day, Hans and Margaret covered 48 kilometers, 30 miles, to Etampes. On the second day, 32 kilometers, 20 miles, to Aquabui. All this on their bicycles, of course. Third day, roughly 40 kilometers, about 25 miles, to Orléans, where they sold their bicycles for money for a train to Bordeaux. It really was a miracle that they were able to find the tickets and a place on the train.
In Europe, you need papers to travel. It's not a person who can travel. It's only the papers that travel.
Particularly at times of war, having the right papers, having the right stamps on your papers. Paperwork could have been a matter of life or death.
At one of the train stations, they sold their bicycles to buy a train ticket to take them to Portugal, because Portugal was neutral.
From Bordeaux, which you have seen on the map, the Reys proceeded to Biarritz and Bayonne, where, after standing in line for 4 hours on June 20th, they secured the necessary visas to leave for Portugal, either from the Portuguese Consul General in Bordeaux, Aristide de Sousa Mendes, or from the Portuguese Vice Consul Manuel Vieira Braga, acting on instructions from Sousa Mendes. With their visas in hand, they went on to Hendaye on the French-Spanish border, where on or about June 23rd, they walked across the bridge over the Bidasoa River to Irun in Spain, as required. That border crossing was closed to refugees just a day or two later on June 24th. The Reys were incredibly lucky again. Irun was the terminus of the Spanish Northern Railway. From there, they traveled through Spain by train, arriving in Lisbon on or about June 26th. By mid-July, they had secured the necessary papers and ship passage to leave for Brazil. In October 1940, they were able to get to America. I would just like to close my remarks with one final comment. The number of official papers required to do what the Reys did was daunting. For their many journeys, they needed identity documents showing their legal presence in France, permits from the French government to leave the country, Spanish transit visas to travel through Spain, visas to enter and remain in for a time in Portugal, often some proof of some sort of ability to support themselves financially. And usually, at least after the first hectic weeks of the war, they needed ship passage purchased in advance for a specific ship. In advance, meaning before they were allowed to make their travels out of France. It was an organizational and administrative nightmare. As I've said, the Reys were incredibly lucky. And much of that luck was directly attributable to the sacrifices of Aristide de Sousa Mendes. This Portuguese consul general in Bordeaux had been a wealthy and very prominent aristocrat in Portugal and something of a bon vivant before the war. But because he disobeyed the direct orders of his government and helped thousands of refugees like Hans and Margret Rey get into Portugal by granting them visas, he lost his job and he lost his future in the civil service, his civil rights, and his ability to secure other jobs. He had 15 children whom he could not provide for. He died in poverty and disgrace in 1954 at the age of 69. He was surely one of the great heroes of his time. And now I'm proud to present Ema, the filmmaker whose wonderful film you have already seen. Ema.
Hi. Hi, everyone. And thank you, Susan, for a wonderful presentation. So yes, my name is Ema, and maybe you're like, why did she make this film? And this is a wonderful opportunity to reflect back on that crazy adventure of my own. It's now been 10 years since I started to make the film. Then it took 3 years. But looking back even to prepare for this, I realized how young I look. I was just a year or two out of film school. And I actually grew up in Japan, and George is very popular here. I just assumed Curious George was a Japanese monkey. I never assumed anything else. And when I moved to the US to study filmmaking, I realized that a lot of my childhood things like, you know, cartoons, things like that, weren't shared with my American peers, except Curious George. That's when I realized he was global. But I hadn't put much thought into him besides that, except one day one of my friends just asked me, you know, do you know about the authors of Curious George? And I said, no. And she said, you know, there were German Jews who fled the Nazis on bicycles carrying the first Curious George book with them. And I said, what? You know, that sounds incredible. Let me Google the movie about it. And I remember going on the internet and searching for a film about them. You know, I assumed there would be one. And I remember, is my internet broken? Is Google broken? I just could not find a movie about them, and not so much information about them, just one book for young adults by Louise Borden, The Journey That Saved Curious George, and nothing else. And I thought, wow, like maybe this is, you know, I was actively searching for a film to make, a story to tell, and I thought maybe this is it, but I have to be quiet about it. If Steven Spielberg finds out, he will probably make this movie immediately. So I remember being very hush-hush about it, maybe more than necessary, but I was, you know, it was my first time doing everything, and I just got very excited. And the first thing I did was I went to meet this woman called Miss Layli Ong, who you see in the film. She is the executor of the Rey Estate. So she was very, very good friends with Margret Rey. Margret lived into her 90s. And so for a couple of decades towards the end of her life, Layli was her best friend. And as you know, the Reys did not have any children. And, you know, Margret fully trusted Layli to continue on the legacy. And this friend that told me about the Reys was friends with her. And I just went to meet her and started hearing stories. And just one story after another, you know, the fact that Margret seemed so, that she did not like children, you know, and all these interesting character, you know, character stories coming out too. I thought, wow, like, I think I want to do this. How do I make a film? How do I make a feature film? And that was the beginning of my journey. And, you know, I started by kind of traveling across the country. There's a great collection called the Degrom and Children's Literature Collection at the University of Southern Mississippi. There's me there. This was one of many, many visits. I spent hundreds of hours at this collection. There were 300 boxes of things about the Reys. So I just remember it was like Christmas, you know, opening a box. You didn't know what was in there. I mean, obviously his archive, but just like actually it could be the original drawings of the Curious George books. It could be letters that Hans wrote to Margret, like sweet letters. You know, it could be artwork. You know, Margret used to make pottery and you know, things like that too. And there were also these audio recordings. There's a photo of me there listening to their voices. And you know, And so I started to realize that how I wanted to tell the story was as much as possible through their own words. And that could be through audio, that could be through, you know, words they said in interviews when they were alive, things they've written in letters and in private. And that, so that's how I realized that this will be the root of my film. Because as you see in my film, I realized that the way they were, wanted to tell their own story was a story, right? Especially during the wartime, they called it an adventure. They I think chose to remember in a certain way. And I mm-hmm. thought that contrasted with the reality of certain parts of their life. This could be a way to show who they were, but also show the reality of things. So this became my idea. And in addition, I wanted to talk to as many people as possible who knew the Reys. Actually, Louise Borden here, she didn't know the Reys, but she's the author of The Journey That Saved Curious George, this wonderful book that is for children. So it doesn't go in depth into their lives, but it was definitely a reference point. And I met her and asked her how she did her research and people I could meet. And then I just traveled around to meet other people who, you know, knew the Reys. One community in New Hampshire, they made the Reys used to spend the summers in a town called Waterville Valley. And there's still a house there. And so there were, I just showed up there and announced, you know, in the bulletin, I'm here. If anybody knew the Reys and is willing to talk to me, have a coffee with me, please come meet me. And so many people came out, and a lot of them were children when they knew the Reys. And so it was just wonderful to hear the magic of their childhoods. And a lot of that is also in my film. So yeah, this was the house the Reys lived in is still there. And so they preserve it, and you can visit it even now, I believe. So this is how I pieced together. So there was no book about them. I didn't have a book to base it on. It was really kind of grassroots research. And then I eventually had to decide, okay, who do I actually interview? What stories do I put in my film? Obviously I could, you know, there could be a 100-hour version of the film and but no one would watch that. So I had to decide what to put in. This is back in my home, just trying to piece together how to tell which part of the story. Another big shocking thing in the process was I had just assumed that because the Reys were so famous in their lifetime before they passed, I thought there would be a lot of footage of them. You know, they did TV interviews, they were all over the media. But my biggest shock was that apparently in the 50s and 60s, American TV networks don't keep the tapes. So they've been overwritten. You know, I spent kind of a lot of time and resources trying to find even one TV interview, and it didn't exist. So I had to come up with a plan B. This was my plan. And that's when I turned to animation, which you can see in my final film is such a crucial part of it. This is Jacob Kafka, my animator, collaborator. He spent over 2 years on the project with me. Ultimately, he drew 15,000 drawings to make the animation that you saw in the film. This is just an early draft of us figuring out what to do. Filmmaking is incredible because I can't draw to save my life. I just can't draw at all. And the fact that I can say I directed this film, it's really a collaboration and the animation process. I was a little bit afraid to go there, but I just needed a great partner. So that's how we started to fill the holes in a way, but also decide to use animation as a way to tell the Reys version of their life and contrast that with real reality photos or footage as you see. So that was it. And, you know, at the time I was, you know, 24, 25 years old, working as a documentary editor in New York. And so what I would do was I would just work without any days off for maybe 20 or 30 days straight. And then I would take a week off and kind of use that money to take myself and three of my best friends from film school who could do a camera, do sound, do the lights. And we would start interviewing people, mainly in Cambridge, Massachusetts, in Waterville Valley, sometimes in other areas. And we would take this, you know, in the film, you see everybody's in a white background. And I sometimes got asked, like, oh, what studio did you use to do these interviews? And we did not use a studio. We had a white piece of cloth that we would iron, we would fold and iron at every location and hang. And so we did these interviews in people's houses, in motel rooms, in, you know, retirement homes, in libraries. And so we kind of, it was really a makeshift operation. And ultimately I had to make the choice to do white background before I fully knew how the animation would come together, things like that. I just had to make certain choices and run with it. And if I had waited till I knew fully what I was doing, I would have never made this film. So it was really a learning process and getting, I know, kind of like just not, I cannot stop. I have to keep going. And eventually, that was how we put the film together. Maybe 2 years had passed at this point, and I was just using my own money and our friends. And one day the animator Jacob turned to me and said, if I keep going like this, it will take another 5 years for me to finish the animation, because we had the ideas and the sketches, but the physical labor to get it to, these are stills from the film, that just takes a lot of labor. And that's when I realized, oh my gosh, we have to do something about this. And I could have gone the route of getting an executive producer kind of thing to come in and give us some money and help us. But I felt so strongly that I wanted to make sure I kept the control, that, we had figured out how to tell this story, and I didn't want someone to come in and tell us otherwise. So that's why I turned to crowdfunding, a Kickstarter campaign in the summer of 2016. Over the course of 30 days, I asked to raise $175,000. I listened to myself say that, and I look back and I said, I can't believe I decided to do this. It just sounds like such an undertaking. And it was probably one of the hardest months of my life, but I just wanted to share a little clip of the video that I used to call for funds.
It's really been a collective effort within the community of people who knew the race. All of us have come together to tell the story of the race the best way we know how.
This is Jacob. He's been tirelessly animating the film for almost 2 years now. We thought there was no better way to tell the race story. But this also happens to be a very challenging and incredibly expensive undertaking. Each frame is hand-drawn, and we have 25 minutes of this in the film. That's over 15,000 drawings.
For the past 2 years, my whole life has become about, how can I make this film? I would do editing jobs and use that money to do some interviews, or, work for however many days straight so I could get a few days off to go travel to the archives. I'm happy to share that the film is there. We have the structure, we've done all the interviews, the animation is well on its way, as well as what archive materials go where. We actually know exactly how we want to tell the story now, we just don't have the funds to do that. It's so true.
Yeah, so, and it really felt like, I was, and growing up in Japan, I don't know, we don't even talk about money ever. And so this was a very, I really think my personality had to change to do that, to basically ask directly from everybody I ever knew in my life, plus their friends, and then strangers to do this. But I felt so passionately about it, and there was no point in asking for any less if I wanted to actually finish the film. And we just thought that maybe parents who love George would support us, but actually there was an outpour of support from the Jewish communities around the world who actually didn't know about the story at all. Curious George, who had Jewish parents, this type of idea. And so I got a lot of support. And here's just one other clip of me a day before the deadline. It was an all or nothing situation. So, and here's what happened the day before the deadline.
I think I will look back on these few minutes and not remember them. I'm really at this state of total gratitude, exhaustion for sure, and just
What?
Wait, it did an update. It did a hello?
Refresh.
Guys!
Oh, Emma!
So we just made our goal.
Yay!
okay. So we just made our goal. So this should be a super happy moment. I'm just so relieved. So we're at $175,002 with 23 hours to go and 1,380 backers. Thank you.
Yeah, so just a blast from the past for me, but it was just an exhilarating, you know, as, of course, the filmmaking, but this is such a big part of it. And I think it just made me also realize how much this film needed to be made. And so there was a little way to go after this. We ultimately made closer to $200,000 within the time, but also we got so much attention that, you know, after that, distributors wanted our film and we basically had the resources to finish it. And it was kind of a lot of pressure for me to be like, I just have to do this right. And looking back in this period, these 3 years, kind of, you know, me and my closest, kind of like the very young team doing this, and not necessarily, you know, I'm not Jewish. It was maybe not initially like a why her kind of a thing. And I questioned that too. But looking back, you know, I was a young storyteller inspired by two incredible storytellers who were Hans and Margret Rey, determined to also try to become a person that, you know, the stories I tell will outlive my own life, just in the way George has outlived Hans and Margret. And I just wanted to do them justice. And I was, you know, became passionate about becoming a good storyteller like they were. They became an inspiration. And I think that's what drove me. And I've made a bunch of films since. Nothing as hard as that first film. But so this is the kind of the making of this film. And I learned so much. And I hope that you enjoy learning about the rays as well. So now I'll turn it over to Olivia for the next part.
Great. What fun to go behind the scenes with you, Emma. And also, Susan, thank you for really grounding us in the history so that we know that it's a lighthearted film, but it's grounded in a heavy history. So this is the time for the audience to continue putting their questions into the chat box. There are already many questions, which is terrific, but please do continue putting your questions in while I make some announcements. So the first announcement is we have just a few copies left of Louise Borden's book, The Journey That Saved Curious George. So we have 15 copies exactly with Louise Borden waiting to be inscribed and dedicated to the young person of your choice or maybe yourself. So after today's program, you'll get an email with a link to order the signed and inscribed book if you should so desire. Next, let me tell you about the couple of programs that we have upcoming. So in 2 weeks' time, we turn to the Netherlands, and there we're learning about a young woman hero. Her name was Hani Schaft. She was known as the girl with the red hair. She was a member of the Dutch resistance, and she hid a number of Jewish people and did very dangerous work and killed some Nazis and Nazi collaborators. She was a very brave young woman. So we learn all about her. There's a new book out about her called To Die Beautiful. And we have the author, her name is Buzzy Jackson. And Buzzy will be interviewed by Felix Feifel, who's been on several of our programs already. And that's a program not to be missed. It is a free program, and I encourage you and everyone you know to sign up for that. Then 2 weeks later, we get to early March. And let me just make sure I'm telling you the right program. Hang on a second. Upcoming events you can find on our website. So that is a program, March 3rd, called Journey to Freedom. And basically what happened was we had a film crew following our group around. When we did our trip, our pilgrimage called Journey on the Road to Freedom. We've done five of these trips. And on the fifth trip, we had this wonderful crew from the cultural TV channel Arte, A-R-T-E, Arte. And they made a terrific film exploring several journeys. There was the physical journey, such as that Hans and Margret Rey took on their bicycles and trains and so forth. So we had families with us who took the same physical journey, but at the same time, these families who took the trip were going on some sort of an emotional journey, delving into family secrets and silence and all these things, coming to certain realizations at the age of 50 or 60 or 75. And that the family name was actually not what they thought it was, and so forth. So you won't want to miss that program called Journey to Freedom, and that's in 2 weeks. And again, the links will be in the email that you get after today's program. So let's get to questions. The first question is there any kind of a Hans and Margret Rey Foundation that receives their royalties and promulgates their legacy?
So there is something called the Rey Estate that definitely kind of promotes their legacy. I think royalties and so forth is at this point, Curious George is so rich that but not necessarily for the estate, you know, the split between Universal and the publisher and things like that. So I don't know how that works. So that definitely exists. And I know that, you know, Margaret lived over, you know, 20 years beyond her husband. And in that time, she did her the best she could to lay that foundation, kind of protecting George's image, but also understanding the different mediums had to happen to continue George's life. And so she did the best she could while she was alive. And I think now it's kind of on, you know, different people kind of are carrying it on.
Several people are asking about the significance of the color yellow. Of course, here we remember the Holocaust, and yellow has a devastating significance with the yellow star. I don't know if it was a coincidental use of color or purposeful. And tied with that, there are questions about whether the Reys ever considered incorporating the history of the Holocaust or World War II actually into their children's books or their own history. So maybe you could tell us.
Sure, yeah. This mystery of the man with the yellow hat, you know, I really tried to get a definite answer from anybody and looked, there's no definitive answer. I once read Hans tell someone that the man with the yellow hat was based on an explorer friend of theirs that they met in Paris at the expo when they were living in Paris. I don't know if that friend specifically liked yellow, or I don't know where that color comes from. You know, so much of this is you wish they had said more. It's also about, you know, directly speaking about the war and, you know, things like that, but they didn't. And so I think maybe that was by choice. So, but it's interesting though, even the Curious George books, they only wrote 7. So there's a lot of other books now, but the first 7 original books, if you read some of them and you know their background, they do start to blend together. I feel like George is escaping through his own ingenuity, you know, I just think of Hans, you know, literally making bicycles with his own hands to escape, things like that. So you can kind of use your imagination, but the facts from them directly are a little bit scarce.
Okay. So what about the name? So the name Rey is a pen name, right? The name was Reyersbach. And even on the passenger list, they're listed as Reyersbach in 1940. So that was their legal name, right? Reyersbach?
Yeah, I think that must have been a choice that was made at the time. I also saw a question about why Margaret wasn't on some of the early books. And this is also an interesting one where I think we might assume that, oh, maybe as a woman, she was like not, I don't know, allowed that or something, but the way she says it at the time, you know, in the 40s and 50s, apparently there were a lot of women children's authors. So she was advised by the publishers to actually not have her name on as a choice. And then a few books in, she was like, this is ridiculous. I'm writing them too. Like, and she got her name on. So this is just a side note with that as well.
Okay. So what about their Jewish affiliation? Susan, you had mentioned about Margaret's father. So I don't know if you could expand on that aspect. They're Jewish.
I was very interested to find out about Margaret's father, because I and Emma can answer the rest of the question probably better. But neither Hans nor Margaret really spoke much about their Jewish connection, their Jewish heritage, their Jewish culture and background. And I wondered how much it meant to them and what I would like to know more about their families who remained in Germany, or did they? But the one hint that I got was to find out that Margaret's father had been so prominently involved with this cultural, it was an association of Germans of the Jewish faith. That's how it translates into English. And it lasted from all through the Weimar time and until Hitler finally abolished it in 1938. But it's an indication that Judaism was certainly a major part of the background of Margaret. I know less about Hans.
Yeah, I think that's kind of to add to that. It seems they didn't, they were secular definitely by the time they were in the US. And, you know, some of the people I met in Waterville Valley, which was, you know, kind of later in Hans and Margaret's life, and they were older, and these were kids, but some of them actually didn't know they were, you know, Jewish. So I don't know if it was I don't know if they were trying to hide it for various reasons, or, you know, we also know the times, maybe, you know, depending on where you were, things like that, but it's difficult to know. But yes, Margaret's family was such a prominent Jewish family, and, you know, Margaret got out in 35, but her family, her parents just never believed that, like, Hitler meant them as well. So what I learned was they just didn't leave until it was really too late. They had to flee basically overnight, lost all their fortune, got to London, but her father had passed kind of heartbroken within a year or two after, in I think 1940 or 41. So it was a really difficult thing for her, I'm sure, although again, she didn't speak about it so much in her later life.
And then there are questions about Sousa Mendes. And when you made this film, had you heard of Sousa Mendes? And the question is, why was he not included in the film?
Yeah, I definitely had heard about him. You know, there's things you know, there was a 4-hour version of the film, there was an 8-hour version of the film. The film could have been many things and included a lot of things, and ultimately I had to pick and choose. And my choices came back to, you know, rooting it in what Hans and Margaret talked about and kind of like the way they told their story. And I searched so hard for them to, even in their later life, like as they reflected on their life, to mention, you know, if they wondered why they escaped and if certain people were, you know, they owed their life to. And it just, I couldn't find it. And in a way, yeah, as part of me wishes I had included in him in hindsight, but it was considered, and just for this film. And I, you know, as I've spoken about this film throughout the years, I always try to bring it up if I have a chance. And I know there's other wonderful resources about Mendes himself. So that was my process.
Okay, so is there anything more that either one of you would like to say? I mean, we could turn now to some final thoughts. So maybe Emma, we'll start with you.
Sure. It's been wonderful to kind of have this opportunity to speak about this. Thank you all for watching the film and listening to us. As you see, you know, the film is one thing, but, you know, kind of my journey in it. And as also, I took the responsibility very seriously, you know, as I kind of just referred to all these other parts of their life that, you know, I wish I could have included but didn't. And as I did so, it really felt like, gosh, like, am I making the right choices? Because I do feel like this film, as long as George shall live, I think the film can be this discovery for older adults and then for anybody, really. And so I hope that, you know, and this maybe is an entryway into learning about, you know, less pleasant things about the war. And this, you know, from if you're a young child, you kind of have that process. And so I really hope, we gave it our all and now the film's there to live. So I appreciate you, everybody listening and all your questions. So thank you.
Now, Emma, someone is asking if she can write to you. So you have a website, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I do.
So maybe, Louis, you can type the website address into the chat box. That would be terrific. And so, Susan, put this all in context to us. Tie it all up in a bow for us, if you would.
Well, now you have the historian speaking again. And I have to admit that I have thought a lot about what might have happened to the Reys if they had not been able to escape France in June 1940. That's led me to think about the French and immigrant, Jewish French and Jewish immigrant situation in France during the war. If they had not been able to escape from France in June 1940, it became much, much more difficult to do so as the war proceeded. It was much more difficult to get the necessary documents as those who didn't wish those documents to be issued became more organized. So it would have been much harder to get out legally later. But Hans and Margret were young, healthy, strong, courageous, and imaginative. And they had some financial means, and they were not hindered by the presence of dependent children or elderly family members, all important factors. They might have tried, if they hadn't gotten out legally, they might have tried to flee illegally without documents to Spain or Switzerland or North Africa. But such a course was extremely dangerous, and it also became more difficult with time. So the Reys might just have chosen to go into hiding within France. So they could not depend on their Brazilian passports for many reasons to protect them as a sure thing. They would have needed to hide, secure false papers, some means of support, etc. But they might have succeeded in hiding. Of the roughly 330,000 Jews in France in 1940, a tragic and fearfully large number, 80,000 people, died in deportation or were murdered in France. They represented about 24% of the Jewish population. But 76% of the Jewish population in France survived, usually, at least in part, because they benefited from a local non-Jewish French population that looked the other way, did not report or betray strangers, and sometimes even actively helped them in small ways rather than in large. So the Reys might have survived in France, but at the terrifying price of more than 4 years of immense poverty and scarcity and continual terror and fear. Aristides de Sousa Mendes saved them from all of that.
Wow. And it really, really reminds us of the whole ripple effect of one action. Right? That there would be no Curious George without Aristides de Sousa Mendes. That Salvador Dali's paintings made after 1940 would not exist without Aristides de Sousa Mendes. The Huffington Post was founded by someone whose grandmother was saved by Aristides de Sousa Mendes. So for any of you who read the Huffington Post, it would not exist without our hero. So if you just think of the ripple effect of one act of goodness, it's really amazing. And it affects generations of adults who love paintings of Dolly and children who love a little brown stuffed monkey. And so my profound thanks to our fabulous speakers, Dr. Susan Zuccotti and filmmaker Ema Ryan Yamazaki. Emma, good luck with your newest film. Hope it wins all the prizes. Maybe in the coming Sousa Mendes Museum, we can somehow have a Curious George room and have your film on continuous loop, which would be wonderful. So thank you to our audience. And again, we have just a few copies left, so be sure to claim yours and have a wonderful rest of your day, everybody. Be well. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.